then a discussion, then a break, then two talks and a discussion. The idea of the talks is to try to be sharp on time, to have 25 minutes talk, 5 minutes of questions. And the idea of the discussion is that there's no idea. The idea of the discussion is to be as informal as possible. Each discussion leader can do as he or she pleases, and it can either be a question and answer session, it can be a presentation, a talk, whatever. We are not imposing any rules on the discussions. The goal is to make it more informal. And also to make it more informal, we created a Slack channel. So we also created one, since the talks are more or less grouped by topics each session, we created one Slack thread per session. So there are 10 channels there that you can just log in and ask more questions to the speakers or engage in discussions and put whatever you want there. And so I think we'll have some fun mornings for us on this side and some fun afternoons for people in Europe and some fun other time for people in other places. And concerning Zoom, I would encourage people to keep their cameras on. It's more lively, it's more entertaining. But if people want to turn off their cameras, it's also okay. And this rule might change if we realize that bandwidth is a problem, but for now it seems to be working fine. So so that's it. I think I'm not forgetting anything, and I will take into account that I subtracted this time from Grisha, and I will give this time back to Grisha and Tiago. And I think we can get started. So it's a pleasure to have Grisha Korshemsky start this first session of IGST that will be on the topic of hexagons and related things. So Grisha, please take it away.
Hello, everyone. So it's a great pleasure and privilege for me to give the starting talk of this conference, a new format. We will see how it goes. So my talk is the title you see on the screen. It's based on collaboration with Andrei Belitsky, and it relies on these three papers which appeared over last year. So the topic of my talk has to do with solving planar ankle force of Young-Mill theory. So all of us have witnessed over the last few years a tremendous progress in solving this theory. It will be fair to say by now we have well-defined integrability machinery which allows us to solve spectral problem of flotation operator. And more recently, there was a lot of progress in computing on-shell amplitudes a closely related object which are light-like Wilson loops. So going with this logic, it's natural to ask the next question, what about correlation functions? So correlation functions obviously are much more complicated object to compute because they carry a lot more information than Olson objects. But since we are bold, we would like to ask the question, is it possible to compute, for example, four-point correlation function in this theory exactly for any kinematical configuration for any value at Hoof coupling constant? So the idea of my talk will be just to report on some progress, some moderate progress in answering these questions. And what I will do, I will review very special class of correlation functions. So this, I will explain why these correlation functions are special. But the first approximation, you may think about those correlation functions as functions built out of very special class of the operator, which will be heavy BPS operators. So then I will show you that these correlation functions have nice properties. In particular, they will allow us to formulate exact equation, which are coming from integrability approach, more precisely from hexagonalization approach, which will be reviewed by Tiago in the next talk. And then I will show you how those exact equation could be solved in different limits. In particular, I will show you how you could systematically develop strong comic expansion. And finally, I will conclude by showing you comparison with experiment. And by the experiment, I mean comparing of some numerical evaluations of correlation function for different kinematical limits against analytical formula which we will obtain using the approach which I just reported. So let's go on. So as I promised you, we will be talking about four-point correlation function, and we'll be talking about correlation function of special class of high BPS operators. Just to give you an idea, I just listed here three examples of those operators. So this will be single traced operators built out of the scalar field. And here, for simplicity, I have chosen only two scalar fields, X and Z, and they are cobordic conjugated cousins, Z bar and X bar. And here you have like three operators like this. So these operators are very special because they have BPS operators, their scaling dimension is protected. It's equal to the total number of scalar fields, or if you wish, R charge. And later on, we will consider the limit when this R charge goes to infinity. Another way, when the number of scalar fields which enter definition of the operator will be very large. And secondly, two three-point correlation functions of those operators are known to be protected. They don't depend on the coupling constant. They coincide with their values in the Born approximation. So the first non-trivial correlation function will be the one which is involving four operators. These are the topic of my talk, four-point correlation function. And obviously, there is many other Hubble-BPS operators. But what we'd like to do, we'd like to consider a very special correlation function, which was dubbed by Frank Coronado as the simplest one. So it's simplest because it has some remarkable properties, which I'll review later on. But per se, it's a quite complicated function because it depends on the coupling constant. And our goal is to find the dependence. So this correlation function looks like this. So you take exactly this three operator, which I listed here, and you put them in different space-time positions. And then conformal symmetry allows you to fix this correlation function, model of some function which stands in the numerator. And this correlation function depends only on three variables. One variable will be Hoof coupling constants. And I remind you that you're dealing with the planar limit. And two other variables, there's a cross ratios which are built out of the space-time separation of the operators. And as you know, it's very convenient to introduce time to time this variable z in z bars, the way it's written here. So that at the end of the day, we're dealing with a function which is a function of three variables, two cross ratios and Hoof coupling constant. So if you start to compute this correlation function in Born level approximation, you could easily convince yourself that in Born level approximation, the only diagram you could draw is the one which is shown here. So you have point one, two, three, and four. And the Born approximation, the diagram will contain k over two propagator, which are stretched between neighboring points. So there's only configurations. And in this sense, the correlation function is the simplest one. Because if you were to choose different BPS operators, you will have much more complicated configurations. In particular, you will get the one which is depicted on my background, this one, which a bit more complicated. You see it has additional propagator stretching along the diagonals. And this one was dubbed by Coronado being asymptotic one. But what's special about these two correlation functions? You see that there's a lot of propagator stretch between points. And if you wish, this propagator defines you some frame. So this, the existence of such frame is crucial for what's going to happen. So each of these frame built out of the big number of scalar propagators, because I told you that we'll take limit k to infinity. And this fact also is crucially important. So let's continue investigation. And the first thing you could do, you try to turn on the bit of expansion and try to see what will happen if you compute this correlation function at weak coupling. So you have well-defined machinery of finite diagram calculations. And as usual, it happens in equal force theory. If you start drawing all possible diagrams, the number of diagrams will be incredibly large. But if you sum them together, that will be remarkably simple. And exactly the same happens here for correlation function. Namely, if you sum up all diagrams together, you will find that any loop level, the coefficient in front of the power of the coupling constant will be given by the sum of very special class of the integral, which will be conformal integral and L loops. And L number of loops arbitrary. So people have studied this correlation function up to three loops, and they found quite a number of interesting properties. First of all, you must ask the question, what kind of conformal integrals will appear in this expansion? And the answer goes as follows. First of all, there will be very special class of so-called ladder integrals, and I call them simple integrals. Ladder integrals just drawn here, and as you know, they could be expressed as the sum of the polylogs of this form, just to give you an idea about the expressions. But aside from this, starting from some big number of loops, you will have complicated integrals. And complicated, I mean integrals which are not expressible in terms of the ladder integrals. And more precisely, the expression will move more complicated than general Goncharov polylogarithms, which I don't want to draw you here. So what has been observed by special decoupled calculation, that for special correlation function we're dealing with in our case, those complicated integrals appear at number of loops which are correlated to the R charge of the operators. So if you have chosen R charge of operator being k, it's starting from k plus one loops, those complicated integrals will appear. So below this, let's say up to k loops, you're dealing only with the simple ladder integrals. In general, they're multilinear combinations. Now, if you examine carefully explicit expression for this correlation function, which now involves only ladder diagrams, you will find that those ladder diagrams will have a tendency to factorize into some perfect square. So which allows you to formally to write the corresponding correlation function as being square of something. And this something, as you will see in a second, is exactly the octagon which we'd like to compute. So once again, this relation was obtained at weak coupling, and again, it holds up to those corrections, because at the level of these corrections, you have to deal with more complicated integrals, which are not part of the octagon. Another way, the way how octagon appears at weak coupling, it appears as a really special multilinear combination of integrals, which are basically ladder integrals, with some rational coefficients d, which obviously would like to compute. So now if you take this observation into account, the natural question appears, what will happen if your formula for fixed value of the coupling constant send r charge to infinity? So if you send r charge to infinity, what's going to happen? This correction will be pushed to infinite number of loops. Or another way, to any given number of loops, you always be dealing with the first expression. Another way, in this special limit for fixed value of the coupling constant, you're expecting to find that the correlation function will be obtained as a perfect square of something which is built only out of the ladder integrals. And this is a very interesting observation, which was obtained from weak coupling, which turned out to be quite general. But in order to appreciate generality, you have to go to the degradability framework, and this is where octagon appears. So to understand this property, one has to switch gears and to now talking about another approach, which is the approach based on the hexagonalization. And in this approach, you start thinking about corresponding fine diagrams contributing to the correlation function in terms of certain world sheet. And this world sheet will correspond to some integral to dimensional theory on which, in which theory integrable excitation is going to propagate. So if you're thinking about this object as being some world sheet with four insertions of our operators, each of the Abelian operators will be connected by the bunch of scalar propagators. Those scalar propagators defining the bridge. And now in the framework of this hexagonalization approach, you start describing this correlation function as some partition function which take into account propagation of the excitation in all possible directions on this world sheet. And then what's going to happen, at the moment you take limit k to infinity, propagation of the excitation along the, across those bridges becomes very suppressed. And in this way, you will be able to factor out this partition function in the square of two open string partition functions, which contains h boundaries. Four of these boundaries defined by the physical operators, and four other boundaries will correspond to those bridges going through the scalar propagators. So this becomes the starting point, and then turning on the hexagonalization approach, you could further factor out these open string partition functions into product of so-called hexagon form factors. And I'm sure that Tiago will tell you more about this factorization. At the end of the day, what you will obtain is the limit k goes to infinity, and k in this case will be just the bridges connecting neighboring operators, you will get exactly the same perfect factorization into objects, which is now becomes this open string partition function, which itself is given by the product of two hexagon form factors, and the sum goes over all excitation which go from one hexagon to another one, and here's psi denote all mirror excitation which propagate on this world sheet. So in this way, you obtain a non-perturbative representation for your octagon as infinite sum, because it's arbitrary, arbitrary, and each term of this sum is given by some integral over rapidity of the excitations. So this becomes a very nice representation, but if you start to play with the representation, you immediately find that it's very difficult to deal with. Nevertheless, it becomes straightforward to work out the coupling expansion, and if you do so, you recognize exactly the same expansion which had been found up to three loops by specific five-dimensional calculation. But actually, this calculation could be, this expansion could be extended to a number of loops by imposing some bootstrap conditions, namely imposing some conditions of the octagon to have appropriate behavior in different OP limits. So in this way, you have the perturbative formulation of the octagon, or if you wish, correlation function, the limit when r charge of the operator is infinite, and then you have very well the framework of developing weak coupling expansion. Then what's happened at strong coupling? So if you go to strong coupling, a DCFT tells you that the same correlation function should be identified as a correlation function of the scattering amplitudes of four states, string states, which are dual to the corresponding half BPS operators. And now the very fact that those operators are infinitely heavy simplifies the problem. Namely, it turned out the corresponding string amplitudes become semi-classically localized on classical configurations. And these classical configurations correspond to the minimal area which are attached to four geodesics. Each of the geodesics corresponding to some kind of BMN states propagating inside ADS between boundary points were defined by the insertion of the operator. So this picture is very nice because it immediately tells you that corresponding expression for the octagon should have standard semi-classical expression. Namely, it becomes exponential and the exponent expansion goes in power with Hoof coupling constant, square root coupling constant, with the leading term being exponentially small, and it should be interpreted as a minimal area of this open string. And then you open the parentheses and you're adding all possible corrections, which will be interpreted as fluctuation of the minimal area, which hopefully should be able to take into account systematically and serious expansion. In reality, computing this minimal area, it becomes a complicated problem, and it's still open problem until now. What had been done instead, you could compute the same object using so-called clustering procedure had been developed by Shota, Ivan, Didina, and Yufeng some time ago. And if you're turning on this clustering procedure, you will find that this reading term takes remarkably simple form. It has a form of some integral varieties of some would-be particles with certain functions depending on two variables. So the variable xi and variable y. Those variables, they carry information about kinematics of correlation functions. So as I told you, you're dealing with two functions, with function of two variables, which are cross ratios, or if you wish, variables z and z bar. And in this parameterization, z and z bar are expressed in terms of those variables y and xi. So from now on, every time you see variable y and xi, you should think about them as conjugated to the cross ratios, or if you wish, kinematical invariants. So at this moment, you have weak coupling representation, you have strong coupling representation, but obviously you'd like to have the representation of arbitrary valued Hoof coupling constant. So how to achieve this? So at this moment, you look back what had been done in similar context in integrable models. So a long time ago, people have realized that various correlation function integrable models, especially two-point correlation function, admit universal representation in terms of the threshold determinants of certain integral operators. The way how it comes about is shown here. So imagine you have two-point correlation function of certain operator g1, g2 in some integrable model. Then you just could rewrite the same formula by putting a full set of the states, so psi correspond to the excitation in the theory, and then using integrability and bootstrap, et cetera, you could show that this sum could be converted into determinant of certain operator. And this operator h is the one which carries information about the tail of the model. So the representation becomes some kind of the universal, but the tails of the model are hidden inside the property of the operator H. It's quite remarkable that if you now go back to our problem, namely a problem of summing of all hexagon four factors, sum of all intermediate states, it turns out that the same representation holds in our case as well. Namely, you could show that the sum of all excitations allows you to rewrite these complicated objects as square root of certain determinant of semi-infinite matrix. So this semi-infinite matrix built out of three ingredients. So two of them are simple, third one is complicated one. First of all, lambda is scalar factor, which depends on one of those variables which I defined previously, y variables. C is matrix which contains only two diagonal parallel to the main diagonal. And finally, the most complicated objects is a matrix K. So these indices n, m run from zero to infinity, and it's built out of the overlap integrals of two Bessel functions. So Bessel function depends on G, coupling constant, psi, and also there is some prefactor depending both on psi and y. So this becomes quite complicated matrix, but if you knew how to deal with the determinant, you will have exact representation for the octagon you could use to compute octagon for any value of the coupling constant. And once again, the first thing you can do, you could expand the powers of the coupling constant, and since coupling constant is inside the Bessel, it becomes quite straightforward to verify that at any given loop level, this infinite dimensional matrix is actually reduces to some finite dimensional minor. And if you compute those minors, you will find exactly the same representation in terms of the related diagrams which you've seen previously. So in this way, you have a nice representation and you verify this representation at the coupling consistent with everything you knew before. But now the question is, how could you compute these objects? Since matrices are so complicated, without any submiracle, it's most likely you're unable to do any exact calculation. And here some miracle happen. Namely, if you just look carefully to this object, which is product of lambda scalar factor and two semi-infinite matrices, this object itself reveals some interesting structure. Namely, it turned out that by appropriate similarity transformation, you could bring this semi-infinite matrix to the diagonal, to block diagonal form. So basically what happens is that after you apply similarity transformation, the whole semi-infinite matrix factorizes into some blocks with even and odd indices, as there is nothing which interferes. Moreover, the object here, K plus, which object with even indices, turned out to be related to the one with odd indices also by similarity transformation. So these two properties alone guarantee you that if you compute now the determinant of this matrix H, the only dynamical information which you have to carry on is the one which sits inside matrix K minus. And then if you choose the appropriate basis, but realizes matrix K minus a certain integral operator. So in this way, you start from the Fredholm determinant. Using those properties, you reduce it to the Fredholm determinant of much simpler objects. It's simply because this object K with subscript K is integral operator. It's defined like this. So you take some test function, and acting test function, it becomes like this, with some kernel K, which I will define in a second, this function chi. So function chi is the one which is shown here. It's a function which carries dependence on all parameters of the model, Hoof coupling constant, it took kinematical invariance. The most non-trivial part sits here in this function k. And then it comes as a surprise that this function k actually turned out to be a so-called integrable Bessel kernel. So it's special, why? Because in many integrable models, this kernel reappears. Just to give you an example, the same kernel appears in the study of distribution of the eigenvalues of certain class of random matrices. Later, it appears in the solution of the Kardar-Parisi-Jank equations. And even more recently, it appeared as a part of Beiser-Idrich-Schrödinger equation. So it looks like this Bessel kernel appears everywhere when integrability is met. So now we have this new problem. So we simplify a little bit our object. So now we're dealing with a very special integrable Bessel kernel, but still we have to do something with this. And the rescue comes from another method which has been developed in the context of integrable models a long time ago, which goes under the name of the method differential equations. The idea of this method is that taking account the property of Bessel kernel, it's possible to show that logarithmic derivative of the octagon with respect to coupling constant satisfies some set of the exact integral differential equations. So what are those equations? So you start from this object here, which is called potential, which is a function of three variables, coupling constant and two kinematical invariants. And then you formulate equations governing the dependence of these objects on three variables. So derivative with respect to y, g, and psi are given here. What stands on the right-hand side, certain integrals, which involves the function chi, which appeared before, and there is new ingredients, this capital function q. This function capital Q satisfies itself a partial differential equation, which is written here, second order partial differential equations with a coefficient depending on the function U. So what's going to happen if you were to compute to solve this equation, to find solution to this equation Q, you will get something which will be extremely complicated non-local function of U. You plug it back into this equation, then you will find complete set of integral differential equation for the function U itself. At the moment you knew function U, you will come back to this relation, you will reconstruct the octagon. So this becomes self-consistent set of integral differential equations. The only problem is how to solve those equations. And it turned out there is some limits in which this equation nevertheless could be solved. So let me show you these two limits. The first limit corresponds to a very special kinematical configuration when you put four operators inside the correlation function into vertices in a narrow rectangle. Another way, you log in for the limit when two neighboring operators become now separated. In terms of the kinematic configuration, it corresponds to sending one of the variable y to infinity, another being held fixed, and coupling constant being fixed as well. So then what's going to happen in the limit? You're expecting some simplification. Indeed, it first was observed by Frank Coronado that if you do this calculation of V coupling, explicitly from finite diagram calculation, you will find that the logarithms of the octagon takes very simple form. Namely, it becomes quadratic in both kinematical variables, so y is large, psi is fixed, with the corresponding coefficient being function of the coupling constant. Quite remarkably, the coefficient of psi squared becomes one loop exact, and two other coefficients become some function. So now if you go through the solution of the system of the equation I have shown you previously, you could show that actually you could solve those equations. The final result becomes remarkably simple. Namely, one would be able to find exact expression for those functions, function of the coupling constant. So the one which appears in front of the y squared becomes like this, and the constant term, which doesn't affect kinematical variables, becomes like this. Let me emphasize that the limit we have considering here is not conventional strong conic limit, which you would normally take within the idea CFT. Why? Because the way how we approach this limit, we first send y to infinity and then start playing with the g. In normal situations, these two limits should be interchanged. But nevertheless, let's take this limit and see what's going to happen if you formally take this expression for the gamma and take coupling constant being large. Then it's easy to see from this expression that what's going to happen that you will get expression like this. First term is linear in G, then the second constant term, and then exponentially small corrections. Notice there is no correction one over G. There is something which you've never seen before. It looks like by some reason, which we don't quite understand, expression one over G truncates only on this constant term. But nevertheless, Now let's go to the second limit and we could find the exact solution. This second limit corresponds to the conventional strong conic limit. Namely, first you take g to infinity, and then you start playing with different value of kinematical invariants. So as I already mentioned, in this limit, you expect it to find semi-classical asymptotics of the octagon. Namely, you expect it to find a term which is linear coupling constant, then logarithmically enhanced term, and then whole series in one over g. So then going through this method differential equations, actually you could find systematic way how to compute coefficients starting from A2, et cetera, et cetera. And then yet another quite remarkable fact is that the first three coefficients turned out to be subject to yet another mathematical theory, which is called Strong-Segur theorem. And this theorem has been existed in the literature, mathematical literature for some time, but actually to my best of my knowledge, people didn't actually explore this particular theorem in context of the octagon. And in some sense, first we discovered the answer for the first two terms and then verify it. Actually, this theorem gives you a shortcut to computing those terms. But anyway, so after it does settle, you will find that those coefficients A naught, A1, et cetera, et cetera, could be written in a very concise form in terms of some auxiliary function, which is called profile function, which is the function which carries dependence on the kinematical invariance. So psi and y, I remind you of this kinematical invariance. And then you find quite intrinsically that the first term, as expected, agrees with the mathematical result obtained previously from clustering procedure. But the first correction, A1, which would normally be identified with the quadratic fluctuation minimal area, turned out to be universal, namely becomes one, meaning it doesn't depend on kinematical invariance. And for us, at the beginning, it was quite surprising, but later we actually figure out that in the context of this Segur theorem, this universality could be explained by so-called universality of so-called Fisher-Hartwig singularities. And last but not least, at the moment we worked out this expansion, we actually figure out that we solved another problem which was urgent in another part of the archive, namely in the part which people dealing with function determinant. And actually this formula itself, this formula, it goes under the name of the Segur-Hilliard-Katz formula for the Bessel operator. Previously it had been known for a very special class of Bessel operators, but we actually generalize this formula for any more general Bessel operators. Very good. So now we have a weak coupling expansion, we have strong coupling expansion, and we have representation for the octagon in terms of the determinant of semi-infinite matrices. Now we are ready to compare our prediction with the result of numerical calculation. By numerical calculation, I meant you start from the representation of the determinant of semi-infinite matrix, and then you truncate the infinite matrix for some big large size, let's say 100. So for convenience, let's choose some kinematical points, which are shown here, and let's try to compare now numerical calculation with analytical formula. So once again, numerical calculation given numbers and analytical formula, you could develop large G expansion, substituting value of kinematical invariance and just look for asymptotic series which will come out. So here becomes asymptotic series. You see expansion up to G power 18. If you look now carefully at expansion coefficient, you will find that starting from some large number in powers of one over G, coefficients start to explore factorially, which is not surprising. We get used to the idea that series expansion, perturbation series, asymptotic, but what's surprising here is that actually the series are alternating, which means that by applying standard estimation procedure, you'll be able to improve the series and in principle to get prediction out of the series for basically any value of the coupling constant. Just to show you how it works, here I show the slide analytical formula versus numerical values. So all these dots stand for numerical values. Horizontal axis stands for the coupling constant, and vertical axis stands for the logarithms divided by the coupling constant. So this dashed line corresponds to the leading order behavior at strong coupling. A strong coupling logarithms octagon and linear the coupling constant divided by g becomes a constant. This becomes a constant. So if you go from strong coupling, you start from red line, and then you go along this direction, and you see that up to g of order one, the sum perturbative expansion describe data quite well. And if you go to small values of G, you see the perturbative expansion also described quite well. So if you do some more gymnastics, actually you could come up with a curve which interpolate between the two. So let me now come to the conclusion because the time is up. So what I'm trying to show you is the correlation function of this heavy bypass operators in the limit when the R charge of the operator goes to infinity have quite a number of interesting, quite unexpected properties, at least for us. First of all, they satisfy a certain set of integral differential equations. And those equations could be solved at least in two limits, in the null limit, a strong coupling. Maybe there's some other limit to explore. Secondly, even more interesting is that those exact anomalous dimensions which appear in the null limit have recently repeated in the paper which Jorgas is going to talk about. Namely, it turned out the same anomalous dimension by some reason which we don't quite understand control asymptotic behavior of 6-point emission amplitude in the very special kinematical limits. So here again, I put question mark because we don't really understand the reason for this. Second open question is that, as I tried to explain you, one of the reasons why we were able to succeed computing fundamental determinant, there's a remarkable simplification which led us to compute very simple Bessel kernel. And once again, we don't understand where simplification comes from. The next point, as I already mentioned, that series turned out to be Borel summable. And in all examples of strong comic expansion of the CFTs with no so on, it's not the case. Normally, you expect it to have Borel non-summable series, and ambiguity should be related to some WWD corrections. And there is some other direction to continue. For example, what about considering correlation function and operator not that heavy? And finally, even more pressing point, what about non-planar corrections going beyond the planar limit? So these are open questions which deserve further investigation. And with this, I would like to thank you for your attention.
Thank you. So we have time for a few questions before we started a little bit late because of the announcement. So thank you very much, Grisha. And I saw that Kostya Zarembo raised